Before proceeding, please make sure to subscribe and turn on the bell icon for upcoming videos. Hello, and today's video is about sialadenitis. Sialadenitis refers to inflammation of salivary glands. It may either have an infectious or non-infectious cause. The non-infectious causes of sialadenitis includes Sjogren syndrome, sarcoidosis, radiation therapy, and various allergens. The infectious cause may result either from a viral infection seen in mumps, or it may result from a bacterial infection, with the most common causative agent being staph aureus and strep pyogenes. Bacterial sialadenitis is always an ascending infection. By ascending infection, it means that the bacteria from the oral cavity moves from the ductal orifice towards the ducts and salivary parenchyma. This retrograde bacterial flow may result from the ductal obstruction or decreased salivary flow. The ductal obstruction can be caused by sialoliths, congenital strictures, or compression by an adjacent tumor. On the other hand, decreased salivary flow can result from dehydration, debilitation, or certain medications that inhibit salivary secretions. Since there are so many causes of sialadenitis, the focus of this video is sialadenitis resulting from bacterial infections only. Sialadenitis resulting from bacterial infections may either have an acute phase called acute bacterial sialadenitis, or it may get into a chronic phase called chronic sialadenitis. Now let's talk about each one of them individually. In acute bacterial sialadenitis, the gland most commonly affected is the parotid gland. The affected gland is swollen and painful, and the overlying skin is warm and erythematous. The patient may also have low-grade fever and trismus. A purulent discharge often is observed from the ductal orifice when the gland is massaged. One of the most common causes of acute bacterial sialadenitis is abdominal surgery, and the gland affected mostly is the parotid gland. Sialadenitis resulting from abdominal surgery is called surgical mumps. In surgical mumps, drugs like atropine are given to inhibit glandular secretions during abdominal surgery, including secretions of salivary glands. This inhibition of salivary secretions provides a really good medium for bacterial growth. The condition becomes even worse as the patient is kept without food or fluids for so long prior and during abdominal surgery. On the other hand, chronic sialadenitis can be caused by persistent or recurrent ductal obstruction by a sialolith. The gland most commonly affected is the submandibular gland. It usually results from the ductal obstruction caused by a sialolith. Sialography often shows sialectasia, which is the ductal dilatation proximal to the obstructed zone. The patient experiences pain during meal times, because this is the time when salivary flow is stimulated the most. In case if the parotid gland is involved, it's called chronic parotitis. In chronic parotitis, the Stenson duct shows multiple zones of ductal dilatation and strictures. And this sialographic pattern of chronic parotitis is known as sausaging. Coming to the histopathologic features, in acute bacterial sialadenitis, since the infection is acute, the SNI and ducts will be occupied mostly by neutrophils. While in chronic sialadenitis, there will be patchy infiltration of salivary parenchyma by chronic inflammatory cells that are lymphocytes and plasma cells. Chronic sialadenitis is mostly associated with fibrosis. For such association of fibrosis, the term chronic sclerosing sialadenitis is used. Acute bacterial sialadenitis is best treated by antibiotic therapy and rehydration of the patient. Surgical drainage could also be done in cases where an abscess is encountered. In case of chronic sialadenitis, as we said before, that it mostly results from the ductal obstruction by a sialolith, hence, early cases respond well with removal of a sialolith or any other obstructions. Other management includes conservative therapies, like rehydration of the patient, analgesics, sialogogues to stimulate salivary secretions, and regular and gentle massage. If these conservative methods cannot control chronic sialadenitis, then surgical removal of the affected gland might be considered necessary. If you think this video was really helpful, please do like the video and subscribe the channel. If you have got any questions or suggestions, you may write them down in the comment box. Thank you for watching.